I welcome you to this distance service of the Windhoek Central Methodist Church. To our members and friends, we look forward to the day when we can see one another again. Wait, be patient, hope, pray. To anybody who might be watching who is not part of our community, you are welcome to share this time with us. And when lockdown is over, you're welcome to come and find us as well. Come, let us join together in prayer. Lord, in this time, it's almost as if every day seems like the next. We'll wait and the time just stretches. Our fears and worries grow. We begin to realize this is not a 3 or 4 week crisis. We can't plan. We can't make things better. We can't pretend we're not in a crisis. So much weighs us down. So much breaks our heart. So much disappoints us. And then we remember that you walk with us. You talk with us. You refuse to abandon us. Even if we feel alone, we are not. God our Father, we raise our eyes beyond the pain of this time. And we know that you are with us. And because you are here, there is reason for hope. Because you are here, you help us to love and care and to pray for those who are near us and for those we don't know. Forgive us, Lord, for those moments when we think we are left to our own devices. For those moments when we give up hope. Forgive us when we stop praying and stop waiting upon you. Give us the faith we pray. To say with the psalmist that prayer that is recorded in Psalm 116 from verse 12. How can I repay the Lord for all his acts of kindness to me? I will celebrate my deliverance and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord before all his people. The Lord values the lives of his faithful followers. Yes, I am indeed your servant. I am your servant, the son of your female servant. You saved me from death. I will present a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord before all his people in the courts of the Lord's temple in your midst, O Jerusalem. Praise the Lord. Amen. Our New Testament reading today, as every Sunday after Easter, is from Luke chapter 24 and verse 13 to 35. It's a long story, and I invite you to go and read it for yourselves. But here's what it's all about. The two disciples were on their way home, Clopas and his companion. They were coming from Jerusalem, and there was nothing for them there anymore, so they took the road to Emmaus. Going home, heartbroken, hopes shattered, telling and retelling the tragic story to each other. How did this happen? How could it get to this? And as they were talking and mourning, a stranger joined them along the road. And he said to them, "What are you talking about, fellows?" "What?" they said. "Are you the only person in Jerusalem who doesn't know the big news? The one we've been waiting for, hoping for, has died and has been buried." So they told the story again of life ended, hopes dashed, the thing that was going to change their lives, gone. Nothing would be the same again. "We'd hoped," they said, "we had hoped." But the stranger started talking to them and took another angle. He shone God's light on the story of the Old Testament. And as he started talking and explaining, the picture started changing, going back to the scriptures. And he made new connections with the Old Testament. And he started explaining the current events. They sensed that they wanted to hear more from him. And so they came to the place where they were headed. And the stranger was ready to walk along, but they said, "No, don't you want to come and have supper with us?" And so as he joined them at the table, and he took bread, and he broke it to share it with them, In that moment, their meal became a sacrament. He disappeared from their sight, and they looked at each other and they said, "Do you know what? This is the risen Jesus." Their eyes were opened, their hearts beating fast, and they said, "Isn't it like our hearts were burning in us while he was talking to us?" Go and read the story. Now, we don't have any physical get-together activities in the church at the moment until lockdown is over. But if you'd like to get daily notices, little bits of inspiration, encouragement from the members of the congregation, please let me know and we'll organize for you to join the church's WhatsApp group. And you will be able to get some more frequent correspondence from the church. Also, please will you remember that this week was Earth Day on Wednesday. It is a time that we specifically set aside to pray for our natural world and for its healing and its well-being. I want to say happy birthday on your behalf to the following people: Revontia Birkes, John Huingdingwe, Jennifer Ferris, Charles Brandt, Peru Limbiri, and Martha Chadwaya. Happy birthday to you. Shall we pray? Lord our God, we bring to you our prayers for these people who have celebrated their birthdays this week. We pray that you help them to understand how precious they are to you. Pray that they will understand something of how you and the people who love them see them. We pray, Lord, for them in this coming year, that they will be blessed and that they will be filled with a new sense of purpose in living for you. Hear our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. Children, I hope that you're doing well and that the adults in the house are not worrying you too much and that you are beginning to think about schoolwork and doing that which you can around schoolwork and learning while you're at home. But for now, let's talk about something else than schoolwork. I want you to have a look at this picture. See what it is. Have a look. What do you see? Tell the adults in the room with you. Do you see a duck with a long beak? Or do you see a rabbit with long ears? Could you see both of them right away? Or could you see one or the other until I told you what else the picture could be? Here's another picture. Have a look and see what you can notice in this picture. Is this a man playing a musical instrument? Or could it maybe be a beautiful woman's face? Interesting, isn't it? You can see one thing until you are reminded that it could be something else as well. Is it the one or the other? Mm-mm. It's both. Sometimes we only see part of a picture. And we don't realize that there's more to it as well. That's what happened to those two people who traveled on the road to Emmaus. They were walking along, thinking that the man who joined them on the road was just a stranger who was talking to them about the Bible. And then suddenly, the picture got bigger. And they realized when he sat at the dinner table with them and he broke the bread in the way that one normally breaks the bread at Holy Communion time, they realized, we only had half the picture. This is Jesus, our friend, the one who died and the one who lives again. What an amazing thing that they could have walked with him all that way and only realized much later who he really was. But that's the way it often goes for us. We often just see one side of the story, and then we forget that there's another side as well. I invite you, have a look at life around you and try and see more than just one side of the story. Try and notice wherever you are, the beautiful things and the wonderful things as well. Maybe you're getting tired of the adults at home telling you to get on with your schoolwork or to clean your room, and you only see them as adult people who are giving you a difficult time and they are worrying you. But look at the other side of the picture and see how much they love you and want to protect you and show you a way to grow up that you will be a healthy, good, happy adult one day. You know, look at two sides. Don't only remember Jesus dying on the cross, also remember him alive and know that he's with you and listening to your prayers. Look and listen carefully to the world around you. When you look at it, look, especially look for the love of Jesus and the blessings in your life, not only the difficult things that happen to us that we sometimes complain about. And so we pray for all of us, children and adults, that Jesus will open our eyes, that we will be able to see his wonders anew.
capture my heart with this love, because nothing on earth is as beautiful as you.
So many of us love the story of the road to Emmaus. Maybe we love it because we can identify with those two folk who were traveling on the road back to Emmaus. We can identify with the feelings they have, feelings of disappointment and disillusionment and despair and dejection over something they'd hoped for. Or maybe it is that we really love the story because it talks to us about when we walk with Jesus on the road, something is likely to happen when we invite him in. It's really a story about so many lessons. You could look at it and learn from it in so many different ways. But today, when I read the story, what jumped out at me immediately was how it teaches us about worship. Maybe this was really the first worship service that took place after the resurrection of Jesus, and people were starting to learn what it was going to be like when they met together for the next how many hundreds of years, how many thousands of years. And so let us talk about what the story tells us about coming together in worship. This might be a good time to do that at a time when we are deprived of that which we were so used to, of that which we took for granted. While we can't get together for worship in these days, let's reflect upon the act of worship and learn a bit and think through it a bit and allow ourselves to learn something new so that when we get together for worship again, we may grow in a deeper experience of worship. Luke 24 tells a story, and it starts where the two travelers talk to each other about their pain. "We had hoped," they say. Sometimes we get the wrong end of the stick. Not deliberately. We make assumptions. We listen to even some worship songs that are well-meaning, but just get it not quite right when you interpret it somehow. There's a song that says, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of the earth will go strangely dim." It's as if our current experience and what happens in the world, in the everyday reality, doesn't matter when we come to God in worship. As if we're caught up in the seventh heaven. The travelers on the road to Emmaus tell us something different. It is when we come to the Lord with who we are, with what we have, with our joys and our burdens, then we meet him on the road. These two travelers are met by Jesus as they tell the story of their pain. It is when you come to worship with whatever it is in your heart, honestly bringing to Jesus who you are and what is happening to you, that you are more likely to meet him in that worship space. And that's what we want. That's what we need. We don't go to church on Sunday to be seen by others. We don't go to church on Sunday to just mark that another week has passed and that the next week is starting. We don't come to church to be intellectually challenged. We don't come to church to get our children into a good worship habit. We come honestly, wholeheartedly, to acknowledge the Lord as the King of all creation and the Lord of our lives. We come to bring our lives, our realities, our concerns, our pain into the loving heart of God, that God's transformational work may take place in our lives. The psalmist teaches us this over and over and over again. Look at all the psalms and see how the psalmist brings his real life experience to God in his worship. Don't come to God as if you're coming to meet the president, putting your best foot forward. Come to God honestly, with your questions, with your hurts, with your fears, with everything that you are. What happens next to these travelers is they encounter the Word. For them, it happens through a conversation with what turns out to be Jesus. Jesus takes the Old Testament scriptures that they know and he puts them into context. He shines a light on those scriptures and they start to see what the prophets had been saying. Isn't that what happens in worship? When you come to worship with an open mind, a passage of scripture that you know well, that you've read often, can take on a new meaning for you. It can become a healing balm. It can become a word of warning. It can become a call that calls you to follow Jesus more closely, as the Holy Spirit, through the preacher, can bring new life and new meaning to an old story. That's one of the good reasons why we join together for worship. We hear the Word, like those two travelers heard the Word. And hearing the Word opens up for us new possibilities of insights, of understanding, of surrender, of growing in faith, of a closer walk. There's a beautiful hymn that I just love that speaks about the kinds of things that happen in our lives when we open our lives to the Word of God working in us. That changing inner work that the Holy Spirit does in our lives. Listen to the hymn and see how you can pinpoint those things that happen to us as we listen to the Word. The hymn, "My Faith Looks Up to Thee, Thou Lamb of Calvary." The story goes on to describe a meal, but in the hands of Jesus, it becomes more than supper. It becomes a sacrament, and their hearts begin to burn with a new fire. When we come to worship, it is not only about Jesus. It is with him. As we kneel to receive the sacrament, we come in our memories to join those two people at their kitchen table, with Jesus being the one who breaks the bread, is the guest but becomes the host, and shares the sacrament with him. It is when we kneel at the table to receive the sacrament, as if we go back to that week before when Jesus met with his disciples to break the bread, saying that this was what was going to happen to him. It is as if we join them in that upper room, commemorating his death and looking forward to his resurrection. And so these days, as we come to celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion, we remember. It is as if we are there again. But in worship, the sacrament is not only about remembering. It is also very much about a present experience of the grace of God. When we kneel and we receive, it is a deep and amazing moment of union with God, of joining together with one another, of the experience of the forgiveness of sin, of the experience of the empowerment of God's Holy Spirit. But the sacrament is even more than just remembering and a present experience. It is also, as we say, a foretaste of the heavenly banquet that waits for us. Worship is about coming with all that we are and all that we have. It is about a new encounter with the Word. It is about an encounter with Jesus our Lord in the sacrament. But when you read the story, there's one last part to the experience of worship that we often forget. Burning hearts, meeting Jesus. Worship is not done until they're back with their friends and they tell their story. Sharing hope is what keeps us going in these days. When you watch the television news, you every few minutes find some inspirational stories of someone who has recovered from COVID-19, someone who has done an amazing thing for somebody else, family stories, stories about individuals who rise above their circumstances. Now, they've learned that people need hope and people need to be able to learn from stories like that in order to pick themselves up and to find their way forward. It's a real thing. We need to, as Christian people, learn to tell our stories in one way or another to others who need to find the eternal hope that we have. We need to tell our stories of healing, of promise, of courage, to help get the next person through life and into a way of finding Jesus on their road to Emmaus. In life, we need to tell the stories. We need to witness to our faith. Worship will be incomplete till you speak or act in some way that you share your blessing with someone. Because worship is never just about you. We modern people have made worship into a selfish pursuit, but it was never meant to be. It's for sharing. In one way or another, it is for sharing through our words, through our actions, through our blessings. And so don't stop your worship halfway. Find a way to pass on the blessing through words, through actions. Dear friends, till we meet again, let us keep the hope alive. Let us look forward to that first day we can be together again in worship. Let us join the two travelers on the journey from lost hope to living hope, from broken hearts to burning hearts. Amen. Come, let's join the children as we sing together. Let us pray. Lord God, hear the prayers of our hearts as we come to you in prayer. We pray for this earth, and we pray for those who are able to make decisions to respect the earth and to take care of it. We bring to you our prayers for all of humanity, and we pray that somehow, in only the way that you can, you will, through this pandemic that we are experiencing, speak your word to people and communities and nations, that we may turn to you once again. Lord, we pray for the members of our community, for those who are alone and feeling so lonely and removed from everyone, for those who are worried about their families. We pray for those who have lost their income We pray for those who are in the middle of their tertiary studies and don't know what they can do to rescue and salvage this year. We pray for those who are worried about their children, who may be suffering in one way or another. We pray for those of us whose jobs are going to be different when we come through this thing, and we don't quite know how we're going to cope with the next thing that is waiting for us. O Lord God, we bring to you the prayers of our hearts in the name of Jesus, who taught us to say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, for thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let's say together the words of sending. The stone has been rolled away. We will go and share the good news. Jesus walks with us on our journey. We will go with him wherever the road takes us. Jesus has opened our eyes. We will go and serve everyone we see. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen.